Good afternoon, everyone. At this time, I would like to direct your attention to the walls for a video message about Vocation Awareness Week, which begins tomorrow.
Hi, I'm Sister Idelbot, and I'm a Benedictine Sister of Annunciation Monastery in Bismarck, North Dakota. I am the vocation director for that monastery, as well as working at the Church of Corpus Christi in Bismarck. This week is special because it's National Vocation Awareness Week, and those of us at the church that have religious vocations wanted to make a little video to encourage young people to explore whether they have a vocation or not. The Catholic Church supports and teaches us that there are three types of vocations: the single life, married life, and that of priests and religious. Have you ever wondered if you may have a vocation to the priesthood or religious life? Do you have a strong love for Jesus, his people, and the church? Do you want to deepen your understanding of Jesus? Are you somebody that people come to in their time of need? If you answered yes to any or all of these questions,
you could have a vocation.
I knew I was called to the priesthood after several years of formation in the seminary. The seminary is about the church discerning with me. But I think that the reason why I chose ultimately to be ordained was I truly believed I was called, and one who is called will first begin to think that you are called. So with priests assisting me in my discernment, that's how I made the decision.
Through my prayer life is where my vocation came, and it was a nagging, gnawing voice that just wouldn't go away. I thought I was in a midlife crisis just because of my age, so it took me a couple years just to make sure I wasn't in a midlife crisis, but through my prayer life, the Holy Spirit spoke to me.
Already in fourth grade, I was thinking about being a sister, and I said that. And then I was challenged. At eighth grade, I thought about it. In 12th grade, I thought about it.
When I thought that I may have a religious vocation, the first thought that ran through my head was, I don't want to do this. Why? Me? But then I prayed about it and prayed about it and prayed about it and started to list as to the reasons why I should become a sister and why I shouldn't become a sister. And when the list got longer on the why I should, I went to a spiritual director and started seriously discerning my vocation. And here I am. I encourage you to listen with the ear of your heart. And if you hear God calling, you can call me.
Good afternoon again. We welcome any visitors and guests that we have, and we also welcome everyone watching Mass on our live stream. During our 4 o'clock p.m. and 10:45 a.m. liturgies, we have added a space in the lower level community room for those in fragile health and their families where masks will be required. Seating is limited in that room. For your safety and the safety of others around you, we do strongly encourage you to wear a mask while you are here for Mass. We have placed collection baskets near the ambo and altar for you to drop your collection in, as we will not be taking up the collection during Mass. During communion, please remain seated until a communion distributor comes to your section. When you come up for communion, please maintain social distance between families. For those of you sitting downstairs, a deacon will be coming down to distribute communion to you. And finally, after Mass, we ask that you not congregate in the pews or gathering spaces. Thank you. Please rise and join in singing our opening song, For All the Saints.
from their labors rest. You, by faith, before the world confess
your
name, O Jesus, before
ever blessed.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Monsignor.
Let us prepare our hearts once again to celebrate these mysteries of our faith.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest and on earth.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, by whose gift we venerate in one celebration the merits of all the saints, bestow on us, we pray, through the prayers of so many intercessors, an abundance of the reconciliation with you, for which we earnestly long. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Revelation. I, John, saw another angel come up from the east, holding the seal of the living God. He cried out in a loud voice to the four angels who were given power to damage the land and the sea. Do not damage the land or the sea or the trees until we put the seal on the foreheads of the servants of our God. I heard the number of those who had been marked with the seal. 144,000 marked from every tribe of the Israelites. After this, I had a vision of a great multitude, which no one could count, from every nation, race, people, and tongue. They stood before the throne and before the Lamb, wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation comes from our God, who is seated on the throne, and from the Lamb." All the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They prostrated themselves before the throne, worshiped God, and exclaimed, "Amen. Blessing and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, honor, power, and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders spoke up and said to me, "Who are these wearing white robes, and where did they come from?" I said to him, "My Lord, you are the one who knows." He said to me, "These are the ones who have survived the time of great distress. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." The word of the Lord.
Lord, this is the people that
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, see what love the Father has bestowed on us, that we may be called children of God, yet so we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we shall be has not yet been revealed. We do know that when it is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope based on him makes himself pure as he is pure. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he had sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
As we watch the video before Mass, we're reminded that this is the beginning of National Vocations Awareness Week. And I know we are aware of our seminarian, Charles Reichert, and I'm also aware that there are many, many more vocations in our midst. Sometimes, however, we refer to having a vocation as applying only to the priesthood or religious life. We need to remember, as Sister indicated in that video, we all have a vocation. And our vocation, above all, is to follow Jesus Christ. That is the single standard of holiness for all of us. How we follow Jesus. And what has enabled the baptized people to do that century after century after century is the power of Jesus Christ through his real and divine presence in the Holy Eucharist. the Holy Eucharist, is what has kept us together for almost 2,000 years. You received in your home the first edition of The Connection. We have to continue to communicate with all our people. All of our 2,500 plus homes. And so this is one way to periodically do it. This first edition, I talk about Eucharistic adoration. And I write in my article, in the consecrated host, Christ is truly present. And we have the unique opportunity to visit and encounter him through adoration of the Blessed Sacrament. I asked Jen to put up a plate. I call these plates because I'm old enough to know what a slide really is, right? This is a monstrance which we pray before during adoration. The word monstrance comes from the word monstrare, which means to show. And Monsignor Ronald Knox said this, the host in the monstrance is a window through which heavenly light streams into our world, a window which gives access to a spiritual world outside our own. I think that's very, very beautiful. It's a window. And that is what brings us to adoration. I have been consulting my clergy. We had a 7 a.m. deacon meeting and a staff meeting. And after consultation with them, since the COVID shutdown, we will be reintroducing adoration of the Blessed Sacrament here at Corpus Christi. We're going to begin in Advent, the new liturgical year. We're going to begin on December 1st, which is easy to remember. We're going to have adoration here on Tuesdays here in the church so that there's plenty of spacing. And it's going to begin after the 12:10 Mass. If you attend my Mass, that means it begins at like 12:30. And we're going to run it from 12:30 to 7 p.m. on Tuesdays, right here, every Tuesday, beginning in Advent. We're going to begin the new liturgical year by bringing back adoration. And as pastor, I'm giving all the homilies this weekend to encourage all of us to make that happen. And I need you all to sign up. I need many of you to sign up. And I've asked that we have an option for not just an hour of commitment, but 30 minutes of commitment. You can call the office if you want, or you can go to our site and you just click that you want to become an adorer, and all the information is there. The name, the hour that you want. We have to have committed adorers. There has to be people, at least two, always in the church. So I'm asking you to sign up to become a committed adorer. And we all need to remember that adorers pray for us all. As I thought about adoration, I wrote four words this week. I wrote mystery, experience, silence, person. And I just want to visit with you about each of them because it's what I think about when I pray outside of Mass. When I pray before a tabernacle, which has the Blessed Sacrament inside, or when I pray before a monstrance, which shows the Blessed Sacrament, I first think about the mystery the Eucharist is. The Eucharist is the center of our faith. And if you notice, since I've arrived, and I've been doing this for 25 years, I always begin Mass by saying, Let us prepare our hearts to celebrate these mysteries of our faith. I had a man many years ago who became Catholic, in part because I said that. He said, I never realized that what I've been doing, he was going to Mass, by the way, with his Catholic wife for over 30 years. I said, why in the world would you do that? He said, well, it's important to her. Ladies, that's the kind of guy you want to marry. But he said, I just never realized that what I've been coming to is above all a mystery. This is a mystery that we do here. And that's difficult for us to accept. We often want to understand, we want to create, we want to manipulate, we want to control, we want to master things. But to understand what takes place at Mass is to understand the word mystery. These are mysteries of our faith. Think about it. When Jesus said the words at the Last Supper, "This is my body, this is my blood," no physical change took place in that bread and wine. To the senses then and now, to the senses, it looks like bread and wine. It tastes like bread. It smells like wine. And did you notice that Jesus offers no proof to support his claim that it is his body and that it is his blood? Because only faith can justify that. Only faith can justify the bread and wine, not as bread and wine, but as he insisted it is. My body and my blood. And that's a mystery. A mystery is something we understand, but it is something we don't know everything about. Catholics need to be comfortable with mystery. If we don't have a comfortability with mystery, we're not going to believe. I believe because I understand something, but not everything of what has been given to me. We contemplate mystery. Second of all, time of God's experience of me. You know, what we do here is not always about my experience. We often need to just stop doing and be. Some people think that we come to Mass for an experience. And we do. But Mass is also God's experience of me. Jen and her musicians are not entertainers. We are moved with music, but Jen and her musicians use the gift of music to lead us into worship. And part of that worship is that Jesus Christ can experience me. I want him, before I appear before him, I want him to know me. I want him to have experienced a bit of my faith. And I talked about this again and again with my students when I taught high school. Why do we go to Mass? Why don't we go to Mass? Again and again, you know, Mass, I don't get anything out of it. Father, I don't get anything out of it. I said, why is everything something we need to get out of? What if going to Mass is God's experience of me? The Curiares, a great saint, said, all that takes place before the Blessed Sacrament is this. I look at Christ and he looks at me. It's beautiful. Silence in my life is another reason why we pray. There's a lot of noise in the world. You remember my homily about my favorite music channel, 948. Remember that? The easy listening channel. When I turn that on, I remember that my citizenship is in heaven, and I shut off the noise. We need to cultivate silence. Blaise Pascal said this: "The miserable man is the one who cannot sit alone in a silent room and do nothing." What does that mean? It means the miserable man is the person who cannot face herself, be with himself. The miserable man is the one who cannot sit alone in a silent room and do nothing. We're addicted to noise. All the communications today don't help us, always. Our cell phones don't help us. Mother Teresa said, "God speaks to us in the silence of our heart." Remember, in the Holy Eucharist we're about to celebrate, Jesus is as silent in that Eucharist as he was at death. That's how he speaks to us. Finally, another reason we pray outside of Mass is because it leads us back to Mass. Praying outside of Mass, this is my person notation, reminds us that the Eucharist is not a thing. It's a person with whom we have a relationship with. Vatican Council II. Let's not forget it. Vatican Council II said that all Eucharistic devotion comes from the Mass and leads people back to the Mass. And by the way, there is no better Eucharistic devotion than what we do right here. Let's all remember that, the Mass is the greatest Eucharistic devotion ever. But if we don't pray outside of Mass, we're going to get tired at Mass. Because above all, religion is a relationship. Religion is not a set of things to do. It's not a set of things to memorize. It's a relationship with a person to fall in love with, the risen Lord. A wise bishop once told me that we need to look forward to something in our life. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's a trip a year from now. I don't care if it's something next week. We always have to be looking forward to things. We can look forward to this opportunity. Remember, we're going to use the church. We're going to close the doors. It's a perfect opportunity, beginning in Advent, to attend a socially distant event here in the church without coming to Mass. All precautions will be followed. All disinfecting will be continued to be carried out. So I ask that you sign up so that we can get this underway. And adoration brings graces to a parish beyond imagination. My dear people, today is All Saints' Day. We're about to pray after communion that beautiful litany, my favorite. Jen usually plays my favorites if she gives me an opportunity to weigh in. We're going to ask all these saints to pray for us beautifully. That Becker litany is my favorite. Becker wrote it, not our Father Becker, but a Becker. But let's remember, as we pray for all those saints to pray for us, we also want to be saints. And in this life, we can be, in many ways, living saints. Adoration of the Blessed Sacrament is an opportunity for that. Amen.
Let's stand now and profess what we believe. I believe in one God.
I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ. Light from light, true God from true, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation, came down from heaven. Became man, for our sake he was crucified. In the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken. Let us bring our prayers now before God the Father.
For Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, and all the clergy, with the people entrusted to their charge, let us pray to the Lord. For those who hold public office and those who assist them in promoting the common good, let us pray to the Lord. For all of us gathered in this sacred place by faith and devotion and by love and reverence for God, let us pray to the Lord. For the special intentions in our prayer basket and for all who have asked for our prayers, Cindy Becker, Gary Becker, Brigetta McCloskey, Anna Feist, Jim McIntyre, Eleanor Speaks, Ernest Fritz, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the eternal joy and peace of Leanne Huther, we pray to the Lord.
Almighty God, hear the prayers of your people. Grant our prayers as you give us every good thing. Through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for with your goodness we receive this bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands that will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive this wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands that will become our spiritual drink. Lord God, we ask you to receive us and be pleased with the sacrifice we offer you with humble and contrite hearts. Lord, wash away my iniquity. Pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May these offerings we bring in honor of all the saints be pleasing to you, O Lord, and grant that just as we believe the saints to be already assured of immortality, so we may experience their concern for our salvation through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For today, by your gift, we celebrate the festival of your city, the heavenly Jerusalem, our mother, where the great array of our brothers and sisters already gives you eternal praise. Towards her, we eagerly hasten, as pilgrims advancing by faith, rejoicing in the glory bestowed upon those exalted members of the church, through whom you give us, in our frailty, both strength and good example. And so we glorify you with the multitude of saints and angels as with one voice of praise we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, 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 amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word. Body of Christ, bring me to everlasting life.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. With thanksgiving.
Let us pray. As we adore you, O God, who alone are holy and wonderful in all your saints, we implore your grace, so that coming to perfect holiness in the fullness of your love, we may pass from this pilgrim table to the banquet of our heavenly homeland, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing our closing song, We Are the Light of the World.